Morning, Analia. You are Master Collier Coach and the founder of Signature Collier LLC, helping individuals with collier transitioning. So how did you get into workforce development and then helping individuals with their collier?
Oh, well, that's a great question. When I was very young, I was trying to figure out what I needed to do to make sure that I was choosing the right career. And I knew deep down I wanted to serve people. So I decided to coach and advise college students. And that's when I got my degree in psychology and my master's in counseling, in particular, helping young professionals launch their career. And I felt that it was something that was needed at the time. It's still needed.
Yes.
And I was able and have been able to service them now for over 23 years, which I think is incredible. It's gone by so fast. But initially, that's what motivated me to get into workforce development and professional development.
So now you have been doing this for over 23 years now. How do you like it?
Oh, I absolutely love it. It's something, again, that's very fulfilling. And I went into it knowing that it was a profession that when you help someone achieve their biggest goal and dream, there's no amount of money that can fulfill how you feel when that person comes to you and says, guess what? I got the job, or I got the raise, or I was able to move up the ladder into leadership positions. So it's very personally fulfilling. And of course, the money has been good. It's been good.
Absolutely.
I can't complain.
It seems like you're fulfilling two things here. So you love what you do, and you're able to make money out of it. So you're not, you know, there's people who love what they do, but unfortunately they don't make money out of it. But right. You are not in that situation. You enjoy what you do, and also you make a living off of it, which is win-win situation for you.
Absolutely. That's what I call the sweet spot. You know, we want to be able to love what we do every day. I hear so many of my clients now that I work with that get up and say, I don't want to go to work, or I don't, that this thing that I'm doing is not fulfilling. And that breaks my heart, because you can have it all. And I do truly believe that you can have the amazing profession and you can have the amazing salary that goes with
really?
Whether it's working for someone or you become an entrepreneur. And especially now, the world has changed so much. You can do everything from home. I mean, I'm working from my home office now.
So now, did you always have that entrepreneurial spirit in you, or is just something that's kind of like wake you up, like, hey, you got to do this?
That's a great question also, because my youngest, and this is something that I do with my clients. I tell them, what was some of your early memories of your career? Like, what did you imagine yourself you wanted to do? And maybe you had a sense, but didn't know exactly what you wanted to do. And I remember as a young, like I was in grade school, I was asked to fundraise for the school, and we were selling M&Ms at the time to fundraise. And so I knew that I was really good at it, and I wasn't shy to go to the door and knock on the door, because back then you could do that. I mean, well, that still, but you know, it's limited now. So I knew I had this thing inside of me of wanting to be competitive and wanted to grow as a person. And my early thoughts and feelings back then was, wow, this would be amazing to do something on my own. But it was the thought. I was very young. Now going into being an entrepreneur, I think part of what initiated it and pushed me into it, after having a very traditional career in career coaching and advising and directing and managing and all those things at the university, was that I was moving from state to state, city to city with my husband, who at the time was active duty military in the U.S. Marine Corps. And as a military spouse, you know, you love your spouse and you marry them, and you have a sense like, yes, I'm going to marry this person that moves around the country, but you don't really know what it's like until you start moving everywhere.
Yes.
And so every 2 years we started to move, and every 2 years I had to find a new job and, you know, do something incredible during the time that I was there, because I needed that evidence for my next job. And then find a different job where I would thrive and I would enjoy what I was doing again. But through that process of moving, We ended up at 29 Palms, which is kind of a remote area near Palm Springs. Everyone knows Palm Springs for Hollywood, you know, starting going to visit, having homes there and vacation. But up the hill, we used to stay up the hill is 29 Palms, a very large military base, right? And so when you are there, you know that there's not a lot of work. It's very, very competitive because you almost feel like you're on an island of its own, that area. It's kind of separated. It's close to LA, but not that close. You know, it's close to San Diego, but not that close. So you do feel a little bit isolated in that area. But I had this amazing skill set of helping others and helping them write their resumes and get clarity on their career. And I wasn't willing to give it up because there weren't a lot of positions there. And I was having a hard time landing something. Long story short, I also realized that my husband's coworkers and military service members needed help transitioning out of the military into the civilian workforce. So instead of saying, I'm not going to work in my profession, I created my business, Signature Careers. So I created something where something was not there. And I tell clients the same thing. If it doesn't exist, create it. And that's how I started Signature Careers and becoming that entrepreneur.
Yeah.
But I had that little bug. Like, I love the thought of, you know, making my own money and creating my own things and not working for anyone. Like, I love that.
You are waiting. It's just the right moment to come to give you that push. Like, hey, this is it. You got to do something, or you're just going to sit there for the next 2 years doing nothing.
That's right. Absolutely. And so that's where people, you know, this... And speaking of, like, we were pushed, the pandemic hit, right? So the pandemic did that for many, many people. And in particular, women. Women got highly impacted.
Yes, I agree with you on that. But now you founded Signature Career LLC to help individuals with career coaching and career exploration. Can you tell us more about the company and the services it offers?
Right. So at the moment, I mean, my because of the work that I've done for 20-something years, I can literally help from free... bachelor degree to bachelor degree to post baccalaureate, all pretty much the whole, I call it the whole gamut. But in particular, I have a soft spot for two populations. One of them, obviously I mentioned already, it's military service members. They just need additional help to transition. I think there needs to be more support for them. And at one point I was teaching the course where I would help them transition from their service time into civilian workforce for the U.S. Department of Labor and a contractor that would do work for them. But now my focus is on women in particular.
Yeah.
Women, mid-career to late career, I feel like they really got impacted by COVID.
Yes.
COVID hit and women had to be the managers, the directors, the executives. They had to be the coordinators and all those titles in between. And then they had to take care of their children, clean the house and cook and become the pet groomer. And it just became crazy for women. And they left the workforce in the highest number more than any other population. And so I went through that transition also. I was at home. I was a director at the time for a very well-known university, top-tier research in university. You know, at that level, you are expected to work quite a bit. You were expected to work evenings and weekends and those kind of things. But when everything meshes together and it's 5 o'clock and your child is hungry and they're knocking and banging on the door and you have a webinar to put on or some meeting, it is so stressful.
I have to agree with you on that because as a mom myself, it's the same situation. It's the same. And at the end, you kind of like have to choose, okay, this webinar or my kid that's starving outside the door, which one of them? It's like, I need the job, but also my kid is very important. So it's kind of a tough decision. It's not a tough decision to make, but you can't really run away from the webinar either.
Right. So, no. And I would agree. It's tough. I mean, obviously for us moms, we want to say, no, it's our children. Our children come first. But again, you said, if you don't do this webinar and you don't do a good job, then you can't feed your children also. And you can't provide for them. Because granted, most of us, especially here in the US, we have to work. The cost of living is so expensive. So we play this balance of, is it my work or is it my children? And I really feel that with this pandemic, as hard as it was, and as hard as it was to go through this process that we just went through and we're still kind of adjusting to, the post-workforce of today requires flexibility. It requires a person to be able to be the leader and be more attentive and be empathetic and all those things, but also to have work-life balance when we're not working 50 plus hours and neglecting our children.
Yes, I agree with you on that. So now let's talk about the services. I know that you are focusing a lot more in women, which is I don't know if you know, I'm like a woman. I support women. So in general, I felt like we need a lot of support, a lot of help, because we carry a lot in our shoulder. I'm not saying men don't, they do, but I can't really speak for them because I'm not one of them. So right. I can speak as a mom, as a sister, as a daughter, aunt, that it's a lot that we are carrying around. And not just for our immediate family, but also for the other part of the family. That we still carry them around. So I do understand why you choose to support women, because that's also the reason why I make that decision too. It's like, I wanted to create something that where women can come together and support one another when we need it. Because sometimes all we need is someone to cry with, not necessarily someone to tell us what to do, but someone to just listen and allow us to cry for a second so that we can take a deep breath and then go back again and do it all over again. So now, what are all of the services that you offer to women and also the military?
Service members?
Well,
so Signature Careers has two different components. One of them is workforce development and training, and I'm strength-based also, certified by Gallup. And so the way I coach is through your strength, which says, we're not going to look at your weaknesses. We're going to look at your strengths and work with those, because those are going to get you to where you want to be much faster.
Sure.
So then I start with strengths and I offer training for workforce development and leadership for women wanting to climb the ladder and those kind of things, strength-based. And then the other part is career development and career coaching. And that part is where if someone usually is in three stages, either one, you're getting ready to transition out of your current position because you're not happy, you want more pay, you want the title, you want certain things, and it's okay to want those things.
Yes.
First of all, I want to say that. I think it's important to say that. And you're getting ready to transition. You might not know exactly what kind of position you want to go into. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to start with your strengths and your values, your core, what I call your pillar. And you're going to start to see through the pillars of strengths and values, what position or industry best fits with what you want to do with your new career. So it's career exploration. The middle kind of stage, which is stage two, is exploring. So once you understand yourself, once you really truly know, maybe I was this way, 10 years ago, but today I want to focus on women, or I want to have flexibility. Once you get and understand these core elements, then we move to stage two, which is the career exploration. What are some positions? What are some industries that fit with who you are today? With who you are now and what you want out of this next career. Career exploration is looking at positions, looking at industries, interviewing people. You go through a series of exercises. So it's pretty comprehensive. And then the last stage is you put it into action. Mm-hmm. Into action is working on tools like resume. Resume, by the way, is still a tool that is used today, but it's being impacted and really looked at through the lens of artificial intelligence. So most people don't understand how to write a good resume because of that. So if you can't bypass the applicant tracking system, with search engine optimization, then your application, as qualified as you are, is not going to go anywhere else. So we redesign your resume. We look at your LinkedIn, because LinkedIn is pivotal.
Yes.
Oh my goodness. It's so important. I think it will replace resumes. We look at your LinkedIn and branding. And so that's putting it into action. And then you start applying. After you apply is the interview, negotiation, and then we take it from there, whatever else the client needs. But that's a full spectrum of how I can help someone get very clear and land a great position where they're going to get paid more. And every one of my clients ends up in their ideal position, better pay, in the situation they want, whether it's work from home or work, you know, hybrid, you know, half and half. So it's an incredible way to just say, this is what I want, and eventually get that thing. Yeah. But it's a process. That's the problem. Most people are just want the thing, and they want the career, they want the pay, but they don't understand you have to go through a series of steps.
But you have to do, yeah, but because what you are trying to say is that you have to do the hard work. You cannot just want $1 million, but you don't even try to make the $1 million in the first place. So now, one thing that you said that I found very interesting is, a lot of people usually they focus on the weakness, but you don't. You focus on your strength, what you already have. What can you actually have today you can use? The things that you're good at, you're great at it. This is your sweet spot. So I like that idea a lot, because when you're focusing just on your weakness, sometimes it kind of pull you down, kind of like, this is so hard. But if you already know you have this within you and you can just use it to get what you want, I think that's a lot better.
Absolutely. And that's why I use a strength-based approach. It's very important that clients understand that your strengths, some of them are your natural talents. So, and you can even think back, you know, you asked me the question about being an entrepreneur. Back when, in thinking about those moments when I was a kid selling M&Ms, I knew I had the ability to influence people because I was selling a lot of M&Ms, right? So if, you know, and throughout the years, as I was growing up, I became, you know, very involved in school activities and yearbook and student government and volleyball. And I knew I loved being around people. So if someone wants to put me in a room with no one inside and I can't talk to anyone and I'm just working on computers, I would be really miserable because I have this great talent to connect with people. And so why not use that to get what I want and need? Same thing with strength. If I focus on my weaknesses and I said, you know, speaking of technology and computers, right, I'm going to learn how to fix this computer, I would go crazy. Yes. I would go crazy. So really, your strengths are your greatest tools to get what you want much quicker. And, you know, some of the, you know, I believe in coaching also for myself. I'm constantly learning and getting coaching from others. So I was listening to a podcast by Dean Graziosi, and he's well-known coach, right? And he says the same thing. Work with your strengths. Why are you going to put all your energy and money into your weaknesses?
Yes.
Work with your strengths. They'll get you there faster. Yes. And I see it over and over again with my clients.
I agree with that. Like the example you use for the computer. You're not a tech savvy person. And that's okay. It's okay to not be a tech savvy person. But there's other things that you are great at. So you're not a tech savvy person. Okay, there's other people out there in the world that's tech savvy, they can fix it. That's the reason why they are who they are. So I like the idea of focusing just in the good instead of focusing in the bad. For me, I'm not saying weakness is bad, but it's not, it's the thing that just always drags us down just because that's our weakness. When I'm good at it, it's a bad thing. But I think we're supposed to have weakness anyway. We're supposed to have the good and the bad. That's just who we are as human.
Right. And so with strengths, you acknowledge, we say, we don't ignore our weaknesses either. We acknowledge our weaknesses. I'm not good at this technical thing, but guess what? As an entrepreneur, I'm going to hire a technical person to come in and check out all my computers.
Right. Exactly.
So that's where strengths are important, because maybe I'm not good at it, but that other person that's great with the technology and understands how to put things together and is, you know, enjoys doing that kind of work, I'm going to hire them on my team because they're going to be amazing. They're going to love to do that thing.
Mm-hmm. I agree with you on that.
Right. And that's how you can build this amazing team together, whether it's being an entrepreneur or you're working for somebody else. You know, I think a lot of times also as women leaders, we say we're going to do it all when we're at the top or we're CEOs or vice presidents. And it shouldn't be that way. It should be, who on my team loves to do this one thing that I don't like to do or want to do or not good at? But that person is going to enjoy it. And how can I onboard them into this initiative? That should be the frame of thought.
Yes.
Not like I have to do it all. That should not be the way it should be.
Well, the only bad news is we can't do it all. We can try, but I don't know. I don't think that's going to work too good.
Right. We tried that during the pandemic, literally, right? Let's be the everything at the same time. It was like juggling and all the balls falling at the same time, I felt like. At least for me, I don't know how it was for you or for anybody else, but certainly that's the way I felt during the pandemic. Like, how do I juggle all these balls? And I'm dropping a whole lot of them, right?
So yes,
it's time to refocus and relook at the workforce and how women work and how women lead also.
Yes, I agree with you completely. So now, it sounds like with your services, you don't just help them get started, but you stay throughout the entire process until they actually land that job. Is that correct?
That's correct. That's correct. So when they land the position, and of course, there's different packages and services, so I do have to be clear about that. When they land the position, if they want to continue working with me because they want to set themselves up for success in this next leadership position, then I will help them and support them through that process. So I get women, for example, going into executive positions, and they're stepping into an environment where there's a lot of change management to be done. Maybe I take them through a series of coaching. One of my specialties is strategy and how to navigate politics in the workforce too, by the way, because I did it for so long at the university. And then we can even go through a next step process, which I follow the Cotter model, where it talks about change management. How do you go in and impact your team in a positive way where you're going to see big change using a step-by-step process? So it's not only landing the position, it's how to be successful in your position once you have stepped into this leadership position too.
So pretty much they can have you for a very long time. You don't just come in for like a few months and you leave, but you can stay with them for a bit longer than that just to continue supporting them and guiding them on how to actually level up.
Exactly, exactly right. Throughout all the steps, I am there to support them because I've been through all the steps. Yep. Being at the university 23 years, I worked every position I felt like you can think of on different sides, because my last position was a faculty position. So I've done the administration, I've done the coaching and the advising, coordinating, you name it. I'm not going to continue naming all the titles. It's been a long time. And being in many different universities, public and private, and also 2-year and 4-year, gave me insight to how management works at all different levels. And just so you can understand like the scope of the work that I've done at the university levels, I have been able to land positions in 8 different higher educational institutions.
Wow.
And that's a lot. And again, it's because my husband was moving, so I had to quit my job and find a new one. And then, so that made me a more of an expert in career, search and job search. I know what works, what doesn't work. And I know how to go into a new situation and be very successful very quickly. So
did you create a plan for that? It's kind of like, okay, I'm moving in 2 years. So I need to do this, and that. So the next one, I can get land this position.
Absolutely. And that's part of what I teach women. I tell them, I'm glad that you got this position. Now I want you to think about your next career step. And they're like, what are you talking about, Analia? But I just landed this position. Are you crazy? We just went through this whole process. I'm like, yes, I understand that. But now I need you to think about the next position. So when you start the new position, you're going to start the new position with the end in mind, which means where do I want to go next? What kind of step do I want to take next? And what can I get from this current position to set me up for success for this next position that I want to get? Because what happens is, okay, we think about, oh, we landed this position, great. We stay there for as long as we can, right? And then what happens? Something changes, management changes, or you no longer want to do that thing, but you have not prepared for the next step. And in this workforce, you have to be able to be kind of seeing into the future, meaning what else do I want to do?
So
what else can I do to prepare for this next step in my career? Because if you don't, you're going to be left out of certain workforce segments and areas. And so that leads into like studying, making sure that you're learning, making sure that you are skilling up all the time. That this learning thing and skilling up is not a thing of the past. You know, it's not like, oh, I got my degree and that's all I need. It's not every year you have to do something meaningful that's helpful to you in your career.
And what you are saying also, I think that's one of the reasons a lot of people get stuck into one position, even when they're not happy with it, but because that's all they got. You know, the past 20 years, I've been doing this and that's all I know. If I quit, where am I going to go? I don't have anything else. And I think that's the issue. And I think with your idea, even if you stay in that job for a long period of time, but you are ready to be able to move to something else, whatever's happened, because you are preparing yourself for that.
Exactly. So you should always be prepared for the next step. Always. I tell my clients, look at your LinkedIn. How long has it been since you looked at it? Well, it's been a couple of years. Well, you need to be on it on a daily, weekly basis. Okay, daily I get, because I'm on there all the time. But they need to go on there and update things, because you never know. Maybe there's an opportunity. Somebody wants to hire you, and you've been thinking about making that career move. And I've had so many clients say, oh, I got approached by a recruiter and I wasn't even looking, because their LinkedIn was looking that great. They were showcasing themselves properly. And so we're living in this world of online, entertainment and learning. And that also includes searching for jobs these days. So having an amazing online presence has to be part of the recipe.
That's the key.
Absolutely.
So now, how important is a resume in a personal career growth or transition?
So, you know, the resume, and I have debates with my colleagues. I have recruiters say, oh no, the resume is here to stay. It's not going anywhere. And I say, oh no, I think the resume is here now, but eventually it's going to go. I really truly believe like everything will live online. And platforms like LinkedIn are going to be the ones that are going to be stepping in to replace resumes, to replace what needs to be seen from that candidate. And the reason, not only because of technology, it's easier. I jokingly say in the United States, right, we say, you shouldn't put your picture on your resume unless you're going into entertainment, right?
Yes.
Other countries, it's fair that, you know, you put your picture on the resume. But I jokingly say, you don't put your picture on your resume, but that's why LinkedIn is there. Because what's going to happen next is that they're going to go to LinkedIn. And they're going to see that what you're saying is true. And they want a validation. Show me the proof. Right?
Right.
Like that famous quote, show me the money. This is right. Show me
the proof. So now, do you provide your services anywhere within United States or outside of United States?
Internationally. So I do get clients that contact me internationally. And of course, it's always the time zone that we have to work out. But once that's worked out, no problem. It's not we can work together. And all the work that I do is virtual.
Yes.
I do a lot of coaching virtual. I do in-person also training. Yeah. That's mostly with the training workforce development. So any strength-based training, any change management, I will go in person if they request me to be in person. So, whoever's out there listening to this, and if you want me to go internationally, I'm there. Okay. Just let's talk.
I'm ready for it. Besides speaking and coaching, you also engage in multiple other activities. Can you throw some more light on them?
Mm-hmm, absolutely. Part of what I love to do is volunteer my time. So again, all within workforce development and coaching. And so I do volunteer my time to help young women in bio, for example. These are professional associations. I do volunteer work for the Honor Foundation, and they help military service members transition successfully. These are usually the elite military service members, like the Navy SEALs, the Green Berets. So I love to volunteer. Obviously, I can only do it a certain amount because I have to work and I have a lot of other engagements. But every year I refocus and say, okay, where do I want to put my energy to volunteer my time? And then outside of that, I do love to write articles. That's something that for me is important, that I reach out to different audiences in different ways.
Yes.
So I know that I'm going to be doing a little piece for Women Lead. So that's exciting. But it's certainly something that I love to do, contribute in many different ways. And then I do also go to conferences and provide services through conferences where I can reach, whether it's a professional association or organization or a higher education institution, because I do still have a very, you know, soft spot for my higher education colleagues when they ask me to come back and give a training or two. And so that's part of the other work that I do.
I don't know where you find time.
I know. I was just talking to my colleague from UCLA, and she said, I said, yes, I'm busy, but you know what? I can always get more work. And I know I'm crazy. It's nuts, but that's just who I am. I'm constantly thinking about what else?
You're like, what's next? I'm ready. Let's go.
I am always ready. And one of my strengths is futuristic. And so futuristic says you live in the future. You plan for the future. You think about the future. Yes. And you can see things as if they're already happening. So yes. This particular strength for me is amazing for my career, but it's also great for working with clients too.
Clients, exactly. So you have that spirit in you when you are with your client. It's kind of like the fact that you are, you know, it's kind of like, I'm ready. Let's do this. It's also kind of helped them to get that vibe from you. Let's say, for example, if you meet with somebody, the next thing we're gonna do is, sound good. It's kind of like, oh, this is so boring, I'm about to fall asleep. You don't sound like that. It's kind of like, let's get this done, I'm ready for it.
right, because with the coaching, it's not only coaching, and again, my background is in psychology and counseling, so I do have that skill set, and there are differences between coaching, yes, you know, at counseling and advising. And there are certain times where I have to be the coach, where I have to say, no, I know you can do this. I know you can make this happen. Let's regroup, let's rethink, and let's dig in deeper. And then the counseling part comes in. Tell me a little bit more about that. Tell me how that made you feel. And then it's time for me to zip it up and have my clients talk, right? And then the advising is, you know, I know you want to go into this new school and get this degree, but I really want you to think about, this is the cost, and I don't really think that you need to get that degree. You don't get a degree just because you have nothing else to do. You get it because there's a purpose behind it. That's the advising piece, right?
So you are wearing three hats.
Absolutely. When I'm coaching, it's three. I call it coaching because it's like all encompassing, but there's a difference between the three. And then the last one, the fourth one, is the teaching. Because when you work with me when you work with me and we decide we're a good match, by the way, it has to be a good match. Okay. Don't just go with any coach. Like you said, you don't want the coach. If you're not resonating with the coach and they're like boring and you're falling asleep, that's not a good match. It's got to be a good match.
Flat.
So when a client comes and we're a good match for each other and I feel great, this is going to be perfect. And my client wants, you know, they want to get things done. There's a teaching component also, because I tell them, I'm going to teach you how to write that resume. You're not only going to get a brand new resume, I'm going to teach you how to do it. so that next time you need to rewrite your resume, you know how to do it. You can always come back to me, and I'm happy to take, you know,
yes,
any services, you know, rendered and money exchange. But I'm going to teach you how to do this so that you, when we're done working together, you know exactly what to do the next time around.
So you're not just leaving them hanging like, oh, I'm doing this for you, but I'm not going to teach you. Because I know some companies just do it. They don't teach you because they want you to keep coming back. So
right.
I like the fact that you teach them, even they are going to come back anyway, but at least they have an idea of what to expect on their resume. Especially if they decided they want to work with someone else. That list that gives them, okay, you need this, this, and that. This is how it's supposed to be. So they can, if they get a bad job done, they'll know, okay, my resume wasn't done the proper way.
Mm-hmm. Right. And so I teach them. And so we'll get online. I'll hit the record button. And I'll tell them, hey, I'm gonna give you this recording so that you can replay it.
Oh, yeah.
And I like to add value to the work that I do with my clients, because I can wear all the hats. I can wear the,
yes,
the four hats that I talked about, right? And so it's important that they understand that they're not just going to get a product done. And frankly, I don't like people doing that. I don't like people submitting resumes to some organization saying, this is what I need. They never talk to the clients. They get a resume back and they pay money for some work that, frankly, is not going to get them what they want.
Waste of money.
It's a waste of money. And then they come to me and I said, oh, okay, I see it all over here. Like, what's wrong with this resume? And then they have to work with me. So I'd hate for them to go to someone that doesn't know what they're doing or is willing to do only the minimum because they're cranking out these designs for and resumes for people without really putting a lot of thought and emphasis on what's important for that person to be branded and showcased a certain way.
Yes. It's good to just work with the pool, the person who has been doing it. It's not just the education behind it, but also it's the experience. And with you, you have a lot of it.
Right. Right. And there's a lot of coaches out there, but my suggestion is you don't have to go with me. You can go with someone else, but whoever it is, make sure that it's a good fit. You really know what and understand their services and what they're doing and their qualifications. That yes. It's extensive because you're trusting these people with your livelihood. If you don't get that job, what happens? Can't pay your mortgage. You can't support your children. You can't do the things that you need to do, especially these days with everything being so expensive. So you can't afford not to go with someone that's experienced, frankly.
Yes. So pretty much you don't get that job, you're doomed. You are doomed. So now Widow Women's History Month is coming up and women still need better representation in leadership roles. How would you encourage them to get past their mental roadblocks and soar ahead in their careers?
Mm-hmm. I think it starts with I talked about the phase one with the coaching that I do with women, which is really understanding who they are. Again, a lot of people and women want to go from, you know, like I need a new position or want to change, go into leadership position, but they don't know the process in between of how. So going through the process of really understanding who they are first and what they want. Why do you want that? Why do you want to sit at the, you know, board meeting? Why do you want to be a member of that board? Why is that important to you? Is it just an accolade or is it something that you want to get experience in because you want to do more work later? What is it about that? So you have to start with the why first. And you know, people talk about the why, but it is the why. What is it about that time and place, that situation that needs to change? And then I want you to look at the inner person, the leader in you. And we're going to talk about your greatest strength and utilize those to get you what you want. Because if they start with, I'm going to do this one thing and it's going to be amazing, and they don't understand all their why, they're putting a lot of energy into that thing, even if they get that position in the board, on the board. You know, they really have to understand it and they have to be prepared for it. Because leadership positions, by the way, as glamorous as they may sound, can be very difficult and very trying. So you have to know yourself as a leader because when you get approached with certain things or challenged, you have to stand your ground. And so if you don't know who you are and how to do that, then how do you become successful in this new position?
Your why. Know your why.
Know your why. Because it's the why that's going to get you through those tough times.
Yes, I agree with that. I know that for sure.
It's your big why, like, oh, you know, it's that whole blood, sweat, and tears thing. You know, it's not easy being a leader. It sounds glamorous, yes, and it's great, and it's powerful, but it's not easy, and it can get very lonely. So if you understand your why, your strength, your skill sets, and why you're wanting to do this thing, you can, during those difficult moments, you can utilize all that you know about yourself to move forward, to be the great leader, to listen to your own intuition.
Something right? We don't like doing sometimes.
Oh, the best advice, you know, is like that I've gotten is listen to your intuition. Your intuition is usually right.
Yes, it's usually right. Thank you so much, Anavia, for giving me that chance to talk to you about your company, also learn a little bit more about yourself. How did you get started? And starting a business as a woman, sometimes we get very lonely because you don't know who to approach, or can I talk to, or the business. And yes, right now it's getting better because we can get a coach, we can do this. But sometimes it's good to know that you're not alone. There's other businesswomen out there that's actually paving the path and working hard and make sure that other women get somewhere eventually in life. And every day I get to meet other women like that. So I'm just grateful and to have this conversation with you and be able to know your why. Actually, I get to know your why and also how you are helping and your vision for your company and where you want to take it.
Absolutely, Nagilia. It's been my pleasure and it's my desire to continue helping women in many ways.
Let's keep doing that. Yes.
Absolutely.